We'll call to order the meeting of the North Reading School Committee, 6:30, regular meeting. We usually start our meetings out with public input, and we'd like to see if there's anybody that has anything they'd like to say. It's not on our agenda. Seeing none, we have something actually to put in there ourselves. We've learned that Bob Terrazas of the transcript is retiring, and we've looked over the past 40 years and concluded that he's been a real good supporter, a comprehensive way of the school committee and of all other actions in town, actually. I have appreciated all the photos of my grandchildren that I find in the paper. I'm sure that most of the folks in the room are feeling the same way.
About your grandchildren?
No. About all of the photos of their family and careful attention to all of the events in town. Bob's everywhere. You're everywhere. The Apple Festival, the games, just about everything that happens in town. And that's a substantial input to the town. So as a result, we have a plaque that we'd like to provide to Bob. In commemoration of that, it says, presented to Bob Terrazas on behalf of the North Reading Public Schools in appreciation of your 40 years of service and support of the school district.
From the old school?
It's not a brick.
Brick from the new school. I hear there were plaques left over.
There are, Bob.
I'm trying to find out where they go, Bob.
The inscription says, you've made a difference.
Yeah. Well, thank you.
And that's a heartfelt feeling here. Yeah.
Thank you.
I also have two cards, one from Beth Thompson.
Thank you, Beth.
I think she's
she's here.
And another from Laurie.
Laurie Capizzuto.
Oh, yeah. Thank you, Laurie. Thank you.
And some of you folks, I'll put it to the rest of the committee first to add to those, to my comments.
Well, I've known Bob for 25 years, dealing with town government. And I know that when you read a story that Bob wrote, you didn't have to fact check it. I mean, it was accurate. A lot of the stories he wrote involved meetings that I was at. And when you read it, that's what happened. Dan's getting close to that. He's getting close to that. No, but in all seriousness, I mean, you knew that that was the right story. You knew it was accurate. Bob was, he was always fair with everything he wrote. He never threw anybody under the bus, and I know people look at that in different ways when you're a journalist and you're a reporter, but he always treated everybody fairly. And I certainly appreciated that because I've said a lot of things that could have come across in the newspaper the wrong way. And Bob was kind enough to edit those things. Tonight, walking in, when I saw him and Vicky coming in, honestly, I assumed that was the end of the transcript. I really did. I thought that was the end of the paper. I don't know how. I know you're going to do a good job, but to fill those shoes and to fill all that space in the paper and all those stories and all those deadlines, sometimes I don't know how you did it, Bob. So,
thank you.
Good luck on your retirement.
Thank you.
And congratulations on doing
thank
a
you
great
all
job.
Thank you all very much.
Well, I haven't known you as long, but you're very gracious with your time allotment, and I greatly appreciated that, working with you, getting, you know, the work in and stuff of that nature. So best of luck.
Thank you, Jim.
And I'm sorry you had to cover the selectmen's meetings all these years. I know it took a lot out of you. I know you got very little sleep on Monday nights into Tuesday morning.
No pain, no gain.
I look at this from two angles. I was a newspaper reporter for daily newspapers for 5 years, and I did exactly what Bob does, what Dan does, covering meetings and covering police, and it was a 7-day-a-week, 24-hour grind. And to do it, I did it for 5 years. I don't know how anybody can do it for 40 years. And I just think it's amazing. And as Jerry said, even when I tried to get Bob to throw people under the bus, he wouldn't. And that, so he's a really nice guy. The other thing is, and I think I have my movie right, but I think in the movie Zelig, I think like Zelig shows up at all these different historical events, and Zelig is always there. And that's how I saw Bob. Every sporting event I went to, North Reading sporting event, Bob was there. It didn't matter where it was, what time, what day, Bob was there. And so it's not only covering the meetings, it's everything he did for not only the schools, but for the community. And I remember I was up at the Triton football game this year, and it was a regular season football game. And there were about 1,500 people there. There was no place to park, brand new stadium. And the first thing I see, I look up, and there's Bob going around the field, up and down the sidelines, got his camera going. So, you know, he's in my mind, he's a legend in this community and in the newspaper industry, because the newspaper industry, unfortunately, I don't know how many legs it has left. And the one thing I'd like to see somewhere down the line is I think Bob should be a member of the North Reading High School Athletic Hall of Fame, because I think he deserves it. We're going to miss you.
So first, I'd like to congratulate you on your soon-to-be retirement. Second, I want to thank you for being the eyes and ears of North Reading for 40 years. As a newcomer to this town 6 years ago, I didn't know a lot about this community. How do I sign my kids up for programs? Where are the important events happening in town? And where I can even get a flu shot? My kids now know you as the newspaper man. They even know your car. Everyone told me everything you need to know is in the transcript, and boy, were they very right. Thank you for your hard work in keeping all of us folks in the know. Best wishes on your retirement.
Thank you, Julie. Thank you very much.
Before we pass it on to the audience, I'd like to add just one little bit to it. I'll tell you what the hardest part of being retired is. I've had a lot of practice in this. It's figuring out whether it's a Saturday or a Sunday. And how do you connect to the rest of the world when they call days different than Saturday and Sunday? John.
Bob, I don't know. I've been thinking a lot the last 8 or so days since you told me that you were going to be retiring, and I really... like Jerry, I kind of thought, wow, it's maybe not the end of the transcript, but it's the end of an era, certainly. And I, on behalf of what probably is thousands of students that benefited from your fair journalism and the respect that you afforded the school district over 40 years, I want to say thank you. It's been a pleasure knowing you for the last 14 years that I've worked in North Reading. Whether it was a theatrical performance, Dollars for Scholars events, athletics, human interest stories, you were always available, and you always did such a nice, fair job, and really represented the school district and the community in such a positive light. Definitely a difficult act to follow. Bill, I wish you all the best, but certainly there are some huge, huge shoes to fill with Bob's retirement. And I want to thank Vicki. Vicki, thank you for letting us have Bob for 40 years. I really, I'm sure that, you know, the nights out and the weekend events and such, you know, really, you are owed an awful lot, too, for sacrificing, and I thank you too. It's awesome. Been a pleasure.
You stuck with him now.
Are there members of the public that have something to offer? Laurie?
Thank you. Thank you so much. I feel like I have to give my name and address. I feel like I'm at a town meeting. So, Laurie Capizzuto, 12 Duane Drive. I just want to say, Bob, you take great pictures. Thank you so much. But I remember, and this is kind of somber, about 14 years ago on the anniversary of 9/11, and you can certainly research it, a year later, I was trying to recollect that day. And my son at the time, who is now 14 and a half, was 9 months old. And I just wanted to recollect that day. And I started to jot some notes down. I called Bob and I said, I need some space. If you sent a letter to the transcript, it had to be there by Tuesday morning. I said, Bob, I've got something in my head. I got to get it out on paper. Can you hold the space? And he did. And it was a great piece, and I thank you so much for allowing me to do that, Bob. You are awesome. You'll be missed. Stay around town. Thank you.
I'm not going to say my name and address. But no, Beth Levitt, I just wanted to thank you. I was telling Mrs. Molly on the way in that the reason I wanted to come tonight was because I've hosted the Family Fitness Night at the little school for many years, and it always does what, Chris? Snows. Snows. And he'll be there in 8 inches of snow, 4 inches, whatever. He always comes, takes the greatest pictures. I've got them all in my refrigerator. And I just want to say thank you so much. Congratulations.
Thank you.
We're going to miss you very much.
Hi, my name is Diane Norris. I was involved with the library for a long time. And we had tumultuous battles trying to convince people that it was a really good idea to move and renovate the old town hall. Now, I'm not saying Bob was biased, but he had a skill to explain some very complex issues to a group of people, for the most part, weren't that interested. And I am so grateful that there was somebody who could explain the impact of a debt with an override to the general public and could explain why this was really a great idea. And I've said to him personally, and I believe it, we wouldn't have it without Bob. And good luck in having no schedule anymore. There will be no deadlines.
Bob, on behalf of the high school and its many clubs and organizations and groups that you've covered for so long, and the Dollars for Scholars, that's also here tonight to say thank you. I just, you know, want to say that how envious I am of somebody like yourself whose job is characterized by kindness and sincerity all the time. And that's every interaction that I've ever had with you, the first one, you know, those two qualities come through all the time, kindness and sincerity. And thank you.
Thank you, AJ.
Hello, I'm Beth Thompson, and I won't tell you all the committees I've served on this town, and I have a very simple sentence, and it's a follow-up to what you said. For non-academic, non-scholarly people in town, you could be comfortable submitting something to Bob, knowing that he would correct every error. Thank you, Bob.
Bob, I want to echo what everyone else has said here tonight. I think even the room, the building we're standing in, all of this, a lot of it, just the way all of the pieces of the building project were covered and communicated, all aspects along the way, we owe a lot to you for that as well. So thank you.
That's absolutely true. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Mary Lou Dysart. I'm pretty much Bob's age. I moved into town. It was our first house. I had three toddlers at the time. Went to my first town meeting here in North Reading, because I came from a big city where there were not town meetings. And Bob stood out even then, when he was just a new kid on the block also. He just always expressed things so clearly so that you could understand what was going on. Turns out I would run into him everywhere, as you all have said. As everyone else has said, he's just so kind and good-natured. But still gets his point across without being aggressive towards anyone. And, you know, at this point, I joined the Conservation Commission very quickly after I moved into town. He was at.
Caused a lot of trouble.
Yeah, I know. That was down in the basement where the frogs would hop through while we were having a meeting. You know, and I'm one of the women who managed to stay on the Conservation Commission for a long time. And he's a guy who just gave me the courage to keep going and doing that and not second guess anyone. And I appreciate that. And now you take pictures of all my grandchildren, and you know, eventually, and it won't be that long since my oldest grandchild is 26. Then you won't be taking pictures of my great grandchildren.
Come around, we'll take the picture.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm Nancy Miller, and I was quite involved in a dream and a project in 1980 I think there were maybe six other women who started to have this dream of something called Arts Workshop for Children, which actually was here 20 years, and it was to add arts education. The schools were very welcoming, and we had our program in the schools after school. And Bob covered everything. He was at every puppet show on the Common that we put on and really publicized it for us so that it grew and it did very well for quite a long time and provided arts for children. So I want to thank you for that, Bob.
Hi, my name is Robert Pushkar. I am was a 27-year alum of North Riding High School. Very proud to work here, and I introduced the journalism course to the high school. And as we were into it a few years, El Silvia offered us a page in the transcript, which I seized upon to give the students a chance to talk to the community. And they really shined, I think. I was committed to 7 issues a year, 1 per month, once we got started. And it was a great partnership. And Bob was our liaison. And through that process, of course, we had John Favreau, who was the co-editor, who went on to the Obama administration. And also Stephen Grant was a fine cartoonist. And he is now out in Hollywood working for an animation company. So I just want to say, Bob, thank you very much for that opportunity. The kids loved it, and they respected you. And I think it was a fine opportunity for them to express themselves to the community.
Thanks, Bob. We loved it, too.
I really miss those pages. I loved those pages when they were, you know, being a journalist, ex-journalist myself, I loved those pages in the transcript when they used to have the, I think it was maybe every 3 or 4 issues they had a high school section. That was
once a month.
Yeah, it was great.
Bob took a lot of great pictures, but I see Kerry Vodonk here. And one of my favorite pictures, a great picture, was the front page of the transcript when Kerry won the state championship in volleyball and she was running onto the court. And that was just, you just captured that. Like, you could just read her face and see how excited she was. But that was a great picture on the front page of the transcript.
Thank you all very much. So exciting to see so many people here. It's so exciting to see so many people here. These days, I'm mostly identified with covering the selectmen, but the truth is, for 16 years, I also did the school committee. So I got to see up close and personal how hard you all work to make the schools a better place. And we have a lot to thank you for this beautiful building and for the fine reputation the school department has today. North Reading has always had good school committees. My first school committee had people on it like Bob Masseri, Tom O'Leary, Bill Ryer, Ralph Hudson, Frank O'Donohue was superintendent of schools, Arthur Kenny was the high school principal. That's an all-star team. And when it came time for them to be replaced, they were succeeded by people like Bill Butler and John Bernard. That's another all-star team. You know, the town has always been very fortunate in the people who run for school committee and who run the schools
And that's why, you know, the North Reading Public Schools stand where they do stand today. I just want to say one other thing, and then I'll leave and get out of your hair, because I know it's getting late, but I want to thank my wife, Vicki, for her constant support for all these years. I couldn't have done the job as long as I did or as hard as I did without her love and support behind the scenes all the time, day and night. And I really mean that, and I really appreciate it, honey. Thank you so much. For as long as we've been married, I've been coming home at 11:30, midnight, 1 a.m., and it's always with the same story. Honest, honey, I was with the Board of Selectmen all night.
Until I started televising it.
Right.
The story a little bit.
But who else could get away with a story like that? So I really mean it. Thank you. And the only thing she ever said, I'd come home, you know, at 1 a.m. and I'd start venting about, you know, whatever it was they did that night. And the only thing she would ever say was, yeah, yeah, just turn off the light and tell me about it in the morning. Thank you again, and thank you all so very much. It's been a great career. North Reading's a great place, and I'll remember you all always, forever. Thank you.
Bob, I'm sorry we don't have any cake, but Mr. Bernard would not allow it. It's not allowed in this.
No food in this room.
Yeah.
That's what I said to Vicky on the way up here.
No food, no fun.
No food in the DLL.
Exactly.
What the heck is, you know?
Yeah, get a picture.
I do. He does.
Well, you want to leave it? You want to hold it back? Maybe?
Yeah, I'll hold
it.
Okay.
John, why don't you guys?
Do you want to stand in the
yeah,
you?
Yeah. Put Bob in the middle.
Put Bob in the middle. But Dan, can you get us all?
Yeah.
We play. Yeah. I better button up my coat, though.
I've known you.
Oh, the water bottle.
Dan, should
sorry.
I put my hand like this?
Yeah.
There's
a bubble cover the water slot.
Yeah. Oh, he's not going to hold that against
all of you.
Don't hold that against me.
Should we do two rows?
A little tight. Give me a minute.
Uh-oh. How did Jerry get in the middle?
I just
form a select member.
We need to do two rows. This is too small.
All right. Two rows.
Two rows.
Two rows.
Two rows. All right.
I'll be in back. Jerry, you get in front.
But Julian, Janine.
Yeah.
You need an 18-millimeter lens.
Yeah, I do.
Don't you want to?
Oh, you guys jump in.
Hand him the.
Got everybody?
All right.
Yeah.
Wait a minute.
I'm here.
All right, guys.
If I may make a suggestion.
Go ahead.
How about some of you sit down?
Oh, that's a good idea.
Cliff and I will stand behind.
There you go.
Sorry about that, Jerry.
Take your seats.
What would I do without it?
Listen up.
I know. You would never figure that out yourself, Dan.
Okay, now we can move in.
That's why the pictures are memorable.
Turn
your sign around.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So now we'll sit in the back.
We don't want anybody to know who we are.
Right?
Perfect.
Where are you going with the flash?
Bob, thanks.
Not if I can help you. Not if I can help
you. Bob, thanks a lot. Thanks for everything.
Thanks, Mel. See you at a hockey game.
Yeah, definitely.
Thanks for coming. Yeah. Those are
the
ones you have to kind of organize that. Saturday, Sunday.
It's hard to get over.
It's very slippery out there. So
yeah.
Yes.
It is.
Black ice.
We haven't got any money to pay any claims.
Night, Vicki. Thank you.
Good night, Vicki.
Night.
See you around. Okay. All right, let's move the show.
I think Jensen.
Or is this Russ?
Jensen.
Yes.
We do. I think he thought the meeting was at 7.
All right.
He emailed me. I did email him back.
Let's push it.
We can come back to him.
Yeah. We're going to come back to him?
I think he will show.
Okay.
Hi.
Is there any other public input? Seeing none.
Continued business, MSBA.
So, thank you, Mr. Chairman. So just a couple of things to note since our last meeting. The first is, and I believe I might have updated you on this at our last meeting, that there has been some work going on among the members of the construction team, Doran Whittier, Gilbane Company, and our project manager to reconcile the items on the punch list. The last report I have is that they're hoping to take advantage of the Christmas vacation week, the 3 days that the school district will be open, December 27th, 28th, and 29th, to resolve some of those outstanding issues. And the only other thing I would report to you tonight is that the drainage system, the repairs that had begun late this fall, have been, the portion of that project to take place in the fall has been concluded, and they will resume either in April during the school vacation week or in the summertime when the students are out of school for the year to continue that work. And that's all I have to report, Mr. Chairman.
Fortunately, that's narrowing down.
Yes.
Next item on our agenda is the naming of a school facility. Actually, this
I can speak on that if you want.
I'm sorry?
I can speak on this if you'd like with an update. Okay, so I think, Mr. Chairman, I just want to let you know that I have not received any additional nominations. At your last meeting, you had set a deadline of December 5th for any additional nominations to be considered for the naming of this beautiful space that we're in, the Distance Learning Lab. So it remains the only nomination to date is that of former Dr. David Troten, the former superintendent of schools. I think consistent with the school committee's policy, the next bit of action would be to schedule a public hearing on this. And if the committee so wishes, I can schedule that on your agenda for the January 9th meeting. Assuming there's favorable action at that hearing, the next step, the final step in the process would be to have this placed on the warrant for an upcoming town meeting.
I guess we need a motion to put to have a
to schedule the public hearing.
Schedule a public hearing.
Well, if we do that, given that there is no other nominations, then there's really no need for that committee to meet ahead of time, correct? Because we only have one nomination.
Yeah,
that's good.
Yeah, that's good. I'll make a motion to schedule a public hearing on January 9th, 2017, in accordance with school committee policy, FDCA, in order to discuss naming the High School Distance Learning Lab after former superintendent, Dr. David Troten.
Motion made and second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous. Next item on our agenda is North Reading High School presentation. Mr. LaPree.
Thank you. And thank you for the invitation to be a part of your meeting this evening. It's no easy task to follow Dr. Turas, but I'll do the best I can. As you can imagine, taking an opportunity to promote and showcase some of the programs and initiatives at the high school is always a pleasure of mine. With respect to tonight's presentation, I think it's first important to start broad and acknowledge the district's vision that its schools prepare all students to be productive citizens who thrive in the 21st century. Additionally, in the district mission, the commitment to all students is twice more declared. The high school's statement of core values and beliefs begins with identifying the core values of citizenship, leadership through service, and lifelong learning in an environment that includes, again, all students. The challenge for educators and much of the joy from the job is finding a way to reach all students, knowing that the means may not always be the same. So we are tasked with creating programs that possess both breadth and depth and reach beyond the classroom. And I believe that is what you will get a sense of this evening with our program. Our first presenter is Ms. Jess Buckley, who will present on the Bridge, a transitional student-focused support program. Mr. Gannon, unfortunately, is unable to be with us due to a family health issue. Reading across the curriculum, Mr. Matt Osteen. Reading across the social studies curriculum, the literacy initiative in the social studies department, Mr. Matt Osteen, the curriculum specialist for social studies, is here with us. and Mr. Mike Rose, the Director of Guidance, speaking on the Common Application Boot Camp. So again, a focus on breadth and a focus on work outside the classroom. Ms. Buckley.
Hi, I'm Jess Buckley. I'm the adjustment counselor at the high school. I've presented for you guys before, so I think probably most people know me. Oh, thank you. So tonight I'm going to be talking about the Bridge program, which is new to our school this year. So the first thing we're going to talk about is the origin of Bridge. So schools across, you know, sort of the country and then, you know, even more specifically sort of locally have been responding to the increase in mental health issues. So these are just some statistics about mental health in teens. So as you can see sort of in the lower part of the slide, these are the number of transition programs and sort of the building on, you know, sort of each of these programs sort of year after year. In 2004, there was an initiative in Brookline, Massachusetts, where they piloted a program for students transitioning back to school, and then, you know, from there collected all sorts of data, and then were able to work on replicating that program in different high schools around Massachusetts. And so, as you can see, you know, sort of over the last, you know, 10, 12 years, they've increased, you know, sort of in number. So the 38 for last year, and then we were saying we're number 39, but there might be a couple of more this year. So that's where we're at this point. And we serve about 3% of the student population. There are a number of students who miss a really significant amount of time from school, either due to medical issues or mental health issues. We have students who are hospitalized, you know, sort of unfortunately pretty regularly for both types of issues. We've also seen an increase in concussions over the last number of years. As you can see, even in North Reading, sort of the data has, you know, really increased already. You know, as of last week, we were already at 19 concussions in the high school. It's interesting to kind of think about where that statistic comes from, whether we know how to diagnose it better, whether there were, you know, sort of those concussions were still happening before, we just didn't know about them. But now we actually have a place where we can address these issues. So the goal of Bridge is to help students and families with, you know, sort of that support as they re-enter the high school community, both thinking about their academic, social, and emotional functioning when they come back. Whether or not they are out for mental health reasons or medical reasons, we find that those are very linked, sort of no matter what reason they're out for. Particularly, we've been working with students with concussions, and we've been noticing, you know, because of the restrictions that are put on them, they actually then, you know, can become, you know, depressed and have those types of symptoms. So we're really, you know, utilizing this program to help those students, as well as, of course, the students that are coming back from, you know, sort of longer-term kind of hospitalizations for mental health issues as well. So these are the services that we're providing, social and emotional and academic support. We do a lot of collaboration with students, families, teachers, you know, service providers. It's really trying to, you know, sort of get everybody on the same page around that student to help them, you know, sort of with whatever plan is going to be most helpful for them. We have guidelines, and, you know, we, you know, sort of approach each student similarly when they come back to school and tell them sort of what we've done in the past, but each student does sort of have their own individual plan based on, you know, sort of how they've been doing and, you know, kind of what their circumstances are. So in terms of the entrance criteria, we are working with students who are absent, you know, for some sort of hospitalization, or if they are out for, you know, five days or more sort of consecutively for a medical issue. That could be a concussion. It could be sort of, you know, anything medical. Or if they're absent for greater than 10 consecutive days due to an emotional concern, even if they're not hospitalized. We do utilize our student assistance team, which meets monthly, and that consists of, you know, the counselors in the building as well as administration to talk about students and sort of how we might be able to use the program for students who, you know, sort of either have any of these issues going on or for students who we're hoping to prevent one of these issues for them as well. It is a short-term program. For some students, it can be very short. For other students, you know, we're looking at, you know, sort of a 9 to 12 week period. The hope is to, you know, potentially get them back into their classes, you know, so that, and I think that that's how we're really working on aligning with teachers, is that that's their goal as well. We always want kids to be back in the classroom. We want to do it more efficiently and effectively for the student to be able to be successful long-term. So for them to be discharged, they need to be sort of back in their, you know, classrooms 80% of the time, and that they're not then hospitalized again within the last 8 weeks. And then, you know, about 80% of their assignments are completed at that time as well. At this point, we're in December. We're, you know, about 2/3 of the way through the second quarter. We are currently serving 10 students. We have 4 students that are actually transitioning into the program this week, and 3 students that have transitioned fully back into classes. We also have the ability to offer sort of the longer term services for students. It's nice because now these students have been flagged and we're able to then be able to work with them, you know, whether it's, you know, sort of they come during a free block, for instance, power block and lunch block. If they end up on a reduced schedule, you know, due to the fact that they're not able to sort of take the 8 classes, then they have the opportunity to kind of continue in that bridge program sort of as an alumni, and also the ongoing sort of emotional support for students, because we then sort of know that they're at this risk, and, you know, then the hope is that they don't need to kind of go back into bridge.
If I could just maybe add a couple of little comments, yeah. Then. So really the bridge is kind of the place where information around student need can come from guidance, can come from administration, can come from home, can come from medical
providers, you know,
medical providers outside, and all of those things working together. We saw a need where it's very difficult for students to succeed if they've been absent for school from a long time, very limited in their connection to the coursework and limited in their connection to the class. And what are other schools doing? So we did a lot of research, and Jess has gone to a number of different schools, and we went to the symposium last fall, and Jess and Mr. Gannon and Bob Gannon went again this year. And so this model is one that I think from the growth of the model you've seen, you know, across the state, is something that I really feel, you know, very happy about, that we're able to offer something like this, and the amount of students that we've been able to support in a very short time, in a couple of months, has been tremendous.
Yeah.
And again, unfortunately, so Mr. Gannon serves as kind of the classroom, the bridge liaison to teachers, and Ms. Buckley provides support as her in her role as the school adjustment counselor.
So before Jess sits down, this is tremendous, and I always like to see us being kind of out ahead of the curve. I think the last time you were here, you were talking about a mindfulness relaxation program, and I'm hoping that's still rattling around the walls here, because I thought that was great, too. The question I have is, there's a definite need here, but what about, and I'm not offering you more money or more personnel at this time, but what I'm wondering is how, I think this is going to be a growing demand, and can you even, with 10 students, appropriately staff it and handle the caseload now? I mean, I think I know the answer. Probably it's difficult, but I guess, when we look at the budgets every year, we try to think of where are the most critical needs. This year we added a full-time psychologist at the middle school which I think was, we all thought was highly necessary.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that's why I'm asking in terms of what the demands are like.
Yeah, I think this is a really important program for these students. I think we're saving a lot of money in some ways too, because the goal is to also keep kids in the district. Mm-hmm. So I think that we're trying to get kids to a place where they are able to function much more effectively. I do not think that we were doing that previously, sort of, to this program. Do I think that the kids are getting the emotional support that they need right now? Not to the fullest effect.
Yeah.
I don't. And I think that, when we think about the amount of students that we've already serviced and the amount of students that we're probably going to see throughout the rest of the year, I think that there's a lot more work that we could do. I think that there's a lot that we could do in terms of coordinating better with hospitals, in terms of their discharge. I think that the role could be expanded significantly to really work with these students so that they would be much more successful.
Because in my head, I see this as a half to full-time position just focused on this program. That's what I see.
I would agree, and other programs that we are mirroring, that is the model. So there's one full-time academic person and one full-time clinical person. And so at this point, I'm functioning in my role as the adjustment counselor, and I'm doing my best,
right,
to support it as much as I can. But I think that that's a good point, and I really appreciate you bringing that up.
Thanks.
Yeah. Just have a follow-up question. Is there a need at the other levels in our district, mm-hmm, at the middle school level, at the elementary school level, for this type of transitional program? Do you know of a need?
So, I haven't necessarily spoken with the other levels specifically. I think that there is some thought around how this model could be used in the middle school. In going to the symposium, with AJ, these last 2 years, and also I go to follow-up meetings, as I can, kind of monthly, to talk to other districts. There are a number of districts that are working on expanding it to their middle schools. I think that it is imperative in the high school. I think it's one of those things that is, like you guys were saying, it's a growing need, and I think that it could be kind of coming down the line for the middle school too. And I think that one really neat thing that we've been doing, and this could be used in the middle school too, is the preventative piece of it. Students that are really struggling, it will help decrease hospitalizations. It will help decrease, the number of absences if you kind of catch kids earlier. So I think that that's how it could be really useful in the middle school level. It's a great question.
If I can just speak, the student testimonials that you hear at the symposium and beyond, and you've gone to other schools to visit, mm-hmm, and I think it's certainly something that we see in these instances and in these meetings, but I think to a person, the student says very clearly, I want to be back in school,
right,
but I am so overwhelmed. I can't even begin to think what that's going to look like.
Mm-hmm.
And to be able to offer something now, finally, and say, well, here's a transitional program that's going to get you back into school. And the difference of just being able to come to school and having a place to get reconnected, mm-hmm, it's been,
yeah,
it's the success of the whole, it really is everything.
I would agree, yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Okay, Mr. Osting. Literacy Initiative in the Social Studies Curriculum.
Hi, I'm Matthew Osting. I'm the Social Studies Curriculum Specialist here at the high school, and I'm just going to introduce you to the Literacy Initiative. It's really an independent reading program that we're starting in the Social Studies Department. I just wanted to give you a little bit of the background as to why we came up with this idea, the way the program works, and then really what we hope to accomplish with the students through the program. So it really began with us identifying what our educational values were and then what we perceived in the classroom to be the student needs. And so this is something that's affected a few different programs actually that we're doing in the Social Studies Department. But so we started with looking at our values in the department. Critical thinking was at the top of our list. We really value giving kids the ability to think more deeply, to analyze, to evaluate, to synthesize using information. Historical thinking specifically was important to us, teaching kids to put ideas and objects into context and then to think about themes of continuity and change over time. And then literacy generally, their ability to read and write even more challenging material. We kind of felt like those were skills that really needed some work, and they were things that we value. School-wide, as Mr. Lepret said earlier, we value citizenship. We want students to be able to know that there are resources out there for them to find more information on the candidates that even some of our seniors in this election were voting for, or the issues that they're going to be deciding on. And so this is hopefully something that's going to help them be aware of those. For lifelong learning, we really value students identifying themselves as the motivation for the learning that they're doing, and then seeing their teachers as a guide along the way. And we think that this is a program that's really going to support that. And then the first learning expectation at the high school is that the student reads actively and critically. And this is definitely a program that we think is going to support them in developing those skills. Statewide, the 2011 frameworks for literacy and history and social science, science and technology. I didn't bring any supporting documentation, but I'd be more than happy to supply it for you. And if you look through the supporting documentation that goes along with this program, we're really hitting on some of the key themes that the state hit on, that students are really able to identify not only main ideas, but how the structure supports an argument, how evidence is utilized, and their ability to even cite textual evidence as they're making an argument. And these are all things that are really woven into the program that we're developing. So not only the values, but then also the needs that we saw. Reading skills, generally speaking, were something that we wanted to really encourage at the high school, and independent, sustained reading over time. We're hoping to increase their depth of content knowledge. All of the books that we're choosing for this list relate directly to the curriculum that we teach, be it in, you know, US 1 at the freshman level, US 2 at the sophomore, World History 2 at the junior, and then senior civics and government. So we're really also trying to help develop their historical reading skills, identifying bias and point of view in an author's presentation, to be able to corroborate what an author says, skills along those lines. And then again, facilitating this shift in mindset, helping students to take ownership of what they do. I've been a long-term study skills teacher here at the high school, and one of the themes that we really emphasize in study skills is that for learning to happen, the students really have to be the driver of their learning. And really see the teacher as a guide and a necessary guide. But you know, if they put barriers up, there's really very little that we can do. So we're trying to get them to take ownership of their own education. So that said, we were looking at a variety of different things that we wanted to help students increase. And so this is just kind of to put it into a context for what we've been doing in the social studies department to encourage core knowledge and skills. So we've developed geography standards for each of the four levels, freshman through senior. And then identified a means by which we can get students to interact on a regular basis with a map program so that they're getting constant interaction with a little bit, you know, a different part of the globe each year. We've identified 15 to 20 core academic vocabulary terms for each grade. And these are kind of the heart and soul of the class. You know, for US 1, one of these key terms is constitution or sovereignty. These are terms that we're going to be talking about from the American Revolution straight through to the Civil War. Developing their historical thinking skills, kind of following on those themes of context and continuity and change. We've developed a periodization scheme so that the students can go from prehistory through modern history in the world history context, and then from colonial history down through the War on Terror. And there's 14 different periods that we've identified to really help the students as they're thinking through, you know, one period leading to the next. I teach freshman history primarily, and it would break my heart at the end of the year when a student would leave, and which came first, the American Revolution or the Civil War? I can't remember. So this was something to address that problem specifically. In conjunction with the English Language Arts Department, we've identified a writing rubric that we're using for not only our DDMs, but for most writing assignments, so that the student can see some consistency in the way that they're being evaluated in the development of their writing. We've also identified research paper requirements for all four of the years, which require, you know, especially for freshmen at the academic level, a much smaller research paper, but it's engaging them in a research process that we hope that by the time they're leaving, if they are thinking about going to college, that it's a process that they can take with them and will help them as they engage in the rigor that college is going to provide for them. And so there is that 9-step process that we've identified. We're still fleshing that out. That was something we did at the end of last year. It's really been something that we're really trying to get students a little bit more comfortable with, not only the research, but the appropriate citation activities that they should be engaged in. And then ultimately this literacy initiative, which was kind of a development over last year where we're trying to get kids involved in independent reading. So the way the program actually works is that quarterly students are reading 1 to 2 articles and filling out an article analysis sheet. As it is in its early stages, we're kind of tweaking the way the workload goes. Currently, in the first quarter and the third quarter, they're doing 2 articles, because in the second quarter, they actually, second quarter and fourth quarter, they have their book requirement done. So just to back it up to the second dot under the quarterly assignments there, we do have a collection of articles from the Media Center developing on Google Drive, actually. So students can access a selection of articles that we've already looked for. They don't have to go out and find them on their own. and they can then know that they're getting something that's correlated to their content. So things are arranged by year for the content, and then even to the quarter for the topics that they're going to be studying. We did also open up a current events option, knowing that, especially with the current election, students were very interested in what's going on, wanted to have more conversation, a little bit more in-depth look at those things. So we do allow students, primarily we want them going to opinion sections, not just facts, but also looking at evaluating arguments. So we encourage them to go primarily to, you know, we encourage them to go to the New York Times, to the Washington Post, to the Wall Street Journal, just to get a spread of the different biases that can be out there. But then really encouraging them to interact with these things at that argument level. And then again, at the semester level, they're being asked to read a book. And it's tiered for difficulty so that there are options out there for students that have a higher reading level to challenge themselves, and then also for students that maybe don't have quite as high a reading level to not feel overwhelmed by the requirement. We do have historical fiction and nonfiction options. For academic students, we do give them the option to read both books over the course of the year. It can be historical fiction. For the honors students, we want at least one of those books to be a nonfiction, because one of the things that we feel like in supporting our place in the state frameworks is that we really need to be encouraging these kids to read more nonfiction. And so especially for the honors kids, we wanted them doing that more. There's a book analysis packet that goes along with that, and at the end of that packet, there are some summative review questions. There's some slight variations between the historical fiction and nonfiction packet that really just reflect some of the skills, especially for nonfiction, that we want the kids to engage in. And then the last thing that we're really trying to do with this is encourage interaction with the local library. We really encourage the kids, none of these books that they're reading have to be purchased through both the Flint Library and then the Flint Library's access to the Merrimack Valley Library Consortium. There are many copies of these books out there. So we really want the kids kind of interacting with the library, setting up some online accounts, so that way it's not really a foreign place. They may even hopefully darken the door of the library after the program is over, with any luck. So parents, independent learning, and the honor system, a big part of making this successful is getting parents involved in the process. And so in the packet, we do ask both parents and students to sign, just indicating a couple of things. The first is that they're selecting a book that they've never read before. We want them engaging with new content. Some of these titles are things that maybe in the upper levels of middle school they might have seen before, but we want them reading new content. And then the second is the most important, especially the prevalence of basically cheats that are out there that students can utilize to fulfill requirements. We want them giving their honest interactions with the book, not necessarily accessing online summaries or analysis, because there are just so many things out there for most of the really good books that could help students bypass this. We're not looking for them to have a professor's view of the book. We're looking for them to have an honest interaction with the book. We tell them that at the outset, and that, you know, it's really about them engaging in the reading process. So just to finish up with a few final thoughts about this, one of the things that we're really seeing as a benefit to this is because of the way that we've especially tiered the books, we see it as a differentiated instruction opportunity, encouraging students to not feel overwhelmed, but then also for students at a higher reading level to move beyond what's maybe just an easy, I can get a grade for this, to something that might be a little bit more personally interesting and then also personally challenging. The second thought is that this is a pilot year. We are definitely kind of figuring out exactly how the workload corresponds to the regular course load for the classes that we teach and how this plays out just in terms of the timing over the course of the year, and then even what titles belong on the book list and which titles don't belong on the book list. Some of them we've already identified as, you know, it's at a 7th to 8th grade reading level, but you look at it and it's really perhaps too easy even for an academic level freshman. And the last is just the students and workload. We have been talking quite a bit at the high school about helping to make sure that students aren't feeling too overwhelmed, that they're able to accomplish the things that are before them. And so we're keeping that in mind as we kind of go through this pilot year and stepping back and reflecting. And one of the ideas that's come up is maybe instead of two articles in the first quarter, it's an article and a certain percentage of your book that needs to be read. So we're kind of tweaking the program and playing around with it as we go. But we've definitely identified, I did a variation of this at the end of last year just to kind of give an initial, this is something we want the department to do, and currently we have about 80% of the social studies department that's engaging with this. And so the first book packets will be due in January, and so we'll be able to get a little bit more feedback from the teachers about how the program is going. But there's a bit of positivity about it out there right now, which I'm very thankful for. So that's our independent reading program, so thank you. Any questions? Yes.
I have a comment. If I could do a happy dance, I would. I love this thoughtful, comprehensive approach. As a parent of an eighth grader, soon to be high schooler, it was very disheartening that he did not know how the president was elected. And it involved a quite lengthy conversation election night, popular vote versus the Electoral College. So I think this program could address some of those gaps that we've been seeing throughout the years. I think with the adoption of Common Core, it's unfortunate that social studies has not been a priority for districts, for even the state. So I think this will address that, and I'm very happy to see this. I don't know how happy my son will be, but I'm very happy to see this. As a teacher, I think this is something that should be a priority for all of our students. So
yeah, I appreciate that. It's actually, to be perfectly honest, I have two elementary age students, and their homework nightly is 20 to 30 minutes of reading. And they're naturally readers as it is, but as we were going through the process, and I was just thinking about what I knew some of my student needs were, the process that they engage in just really got me thinking about the idea of independent learning. They select their own works, what they read, and I think it's a little empowering for them. And so I just kind of wanted to see that continue, for high school students. So that's kind of where some of the genesis is the home life experience. So
if I could just add, I like the current events aspect of it, and the reason, one of the main reasons I really like it now is you could probably develop a whole new college major just based on this current election that concluded from post-fact era to fake news to foreign government intervention to hacking to. So I guess, are those some of the things that, because one of the things that concerns me is, teaching with social media, teaching kids how to determine what's real and what isn't. And I think for all kids, that's a critical skill that I think a lot of them are going to have to be taught, because a lot of the fake news looks really real. And so I just was wondering if that's something that you have given some thought to moving forward.
Yeah, we definitely have. I mean, that's why we have somewhat limited the amount of resources we want the kids accessing.
Because,
we don't want them to look to us to have all the answers for them, but we want them to look to us as guides. And
right.
So with that in mind, we've been a little bit vocal about the sort of Facebook news, the Twitter news that the kids are following. And actually, courtesy of one of my colleagues, he shared with me a Washington Post article on the new yellow journalism. And so I put that out there on my website for the kids to potentially do for this, and probably half my junior class actually utilized that. And we're looking at some of the ways in which it's a Facebook news organization, and the entire business model is they make $100,000 in a month or so, just based on the clicks that they get.
Right.
And it's all entirely fabricated, innuendo, a lot of things like that. So it was a very interesting, eye-opening experience that a lot of the news that some people are getting is a couple of bearded guys who maybe don't wash themselves on a daily basis, but
are making a lot of money
producing these news stories.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
It's interesting.
Thanks.
Oh, sorry.
Julian Bell commented on the content. I just want to say it was an excellent presentation.
Yeah.
Excellent
yeah.
Job.
Thank you very much.
Very good, man.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right. We are going to move on to Mr. Rosa, Director of Guidance, and he's going to talk about the Common Application Boot Camp.
Let me start just by thanking everybody for allowing me to speak for a few moments tonight. I've been to school committee a couple times over the years, but haven't been for a year or two, and we had a new program that we started now two summers ago, and I thought folks might be interested in learning a little bit more about it. We've been really excited about it. So we've been running the Common Application Boot Camp for the last two summers, and I thought I would introduce it by just sharing some of the numbers. It will give you some insight into what the program is, and then I'll move from there. But as I mentioned, we ran it the last two Augusts, so we had our second one this past summer. And we had 84 rising seniors attend the two-day event, so it was really exciting for us to get such a large number. That was about a 20 student increase from the first year that we offered it. So, you know, when people have different schedules, et cetera, during the summer. So to get that many kids in the building for a couple days was, we were very happy. And we run it as a two-day event. We run it about, you know, the second week of August, because August 1st is traditionally the date that the common application opens for students for that coming year. So it gives us a few days anyways to look at it, look to see what's in there, and see if there's any changes, and then host the event. So over the course of the 2 days, the students receive about 7.5 hours of instruction related directly to the post-secondary application process. I'll show you the details of that instruction in an example in a later slide. The, you know, who was here, who was running that, it was, we did have all four guidance counselors here this year participating, and then also two of our English language arts teachers, and you might guess they were here to provide some instruction around the essay. So I'll show you how the students access that. And just, you know, a quick number here. So now, and this is an ever-increasing number, 693 colleges and universities utilize the Common Application, and just 52 of them are just here in Massachusetts. So I think you can say that the majority of four-year institutions, at least in Massachusetts, utilize the Common App. And it is, you know, it's still traditionally a New England sort of East Coast thing, although, I mean, it is certainly spread throughout the country and even to other nations. But you know, the point I'm trying to sort of drive home here is that I would say it's safe to say that the vast majority of our students applying to a four-year school are going to use the Common Application for at least one school, maybe several, and maybe even all of their schools. There are some schools or colleges that are Common App exclusive, meaning that is their only application these days. You have to use it. And then other schools will decide not to use it at all. And yet there's some that will publish their own application or use the Common Application. So you can see where students will, you know, usually be using it. So I thought I would share a little bit about sort of what drove us to start this program. And really, I think the essential element is the change in the timeline for the post-secondary application process. It has changed dramatically over the last, I would say, 10 to 15 years. And really what's happened is the process has gotten a lot earlier. It's incredible to me. I remember my first year in guidance in another district, and I actually came across some of these recently. You know, I was looking through letters of recommendation that I had written, and most of them were dated in December and January. I have now written the vast majority of my letters already. I actually checked before this meeting to see, we've already had students submit over 1,000 applications as of, what, December, you know, mid-December. So you can really see how the process has changed. And the other point is, well, and let me just sort of describe the sort of the early programs a little bit more. Some folks might be familiar with the terms. You kind of have early decision and early action, which a lot of schools have added. You know, in that recent, you know, 10 to 15 year period. Early decision is just that program where students apply a little earlier in the process, but they are committing to the school that they're applying to under that program. So not, this program isn't as big as early action, but, or at least, the, you know, not as many schools use it, but the student sort of commits, but they're usually applying by November. Maybe at the latest, a school has a December deadline for that. And then early action is very similar to that. You apply early and you get to hear earlier, but you're not committing to the college. So in a lot of ways, that is the bigger program. A student doesn't have to sort of put all their eggs into the one college's basket, but can still apply if they're ready and hear earlier in the process and not have to wait till what it used to be like, where everyone waited till, you know, March or April to hear. So a lot of students want to take advantage of that. The other sort of effect that we've seen during this time, though, is that the early application dates keep getting earlier, too. So when schools started moving to early dates, you would see them, you know, maybe December 1st deadlines for early action, November 15th, and they keep creeping back. So now there's a whole lot of November 1st, especially some of the more popular schools among our students have moved to November 1st recently. UMass Lowell, I think, last year moved for the first time to a November 1st early action program. So they just keep getting earlier. Even if some of our students are looking at schools down south or sometimes even on the West Coast, we'll actually see deadlines in October. So it's just a lot of changes to the process. So, you know, here in the Northeast, we tend to come back to school around Labor Day and we hit the ground running, especially if a student has an October or November 1st deadline. So some numbers around our application. I looked back to see in 2010 how many sort of early applications were submitted by our students, and it was about 227. And then last year we had submitted 465. So that's really, it's doubled in a short, relatively short time of about 6 years. You know, along with all of this, we certainly wanted to relieve some senior stress that kind of happens in that fall of senior year. I mean, that's the other thing. Students come down. This process has been condensed into this, if we really condense it from, you know, say September 1st to November 1st for a lot of students. That's a 2-month period while they're also, you know, involved in one of the Masters productions and taking their eight courses and, you know, are playing a fall sport. So we wanted to relieve some of that stress. But I cannot, on behalf of the guidance department, take all the credit for this. In all honesty, we worked closely with some students who, at the time as we were discussing the possibility of doing something like this, we were approached by some students who actually were seniors and were graduating, and this was not going to benefit. But really kind of had heard, I think a private school in the area had run a similar program, and they had heard about it and thought it would be helpful. And so I met with them several times to kind of get ideas and what we were tell them what we were thinking here, what they were thinking, and they were really good partners with us. We were able to collaborate and come up with a program. In that first year, when we polled the current juniors that year, so it would have been members of the class of 2015, and we asked them, you know, what they thought. I'm sorry, it would have been 2016, class of 2016 when they were juniors, but we asked them, you know, would you like to attend? And we really got a lot of responses saying, yes, absolutely. And we said, what types of topics? And so we were able to poll them and build the program around that. So I thought, you know, I'll give you sort of the insider's view because it would give you a good sense of what the program is and what it looks like. So we'd have day one. We've done it on a Tuesday. And, you know, students would come in on that Tuesday. We would check them in at 8 o'clock. We would have we end up dividing them up to rotate them through different like seminars and things, but we'd actually have all the students in here. This is a perfect space for the Common Application Boot Camp. It's the right size. We can present, we can walk around as they're working, but they come in and we go step by step through the Common Application. So when the Common Application opens on August 1st, we will get on it. I will go on and do one like as if I was a student just about to see step by step what they're gonna need. We will then push out sort of a form that they can gather the data on, because not every student knows, you know, what's your parents' work number? They ask a lot of, you know, things like that. But we want them to be able to complete as much as the application as they can. So we'll spend over 2 hours with them. We'll present, you know, right here going section by section. And then there's, you know, four guidance counselors in the room who will walk around and help them and answer questions. And we'll just work through the application. By the end, there's always a few things they can't complete until like school starts again, and they, you know, just little things. But I would say the majority of students can get probably 80 to 90% of the application done, minus the essay, which we'll talk about. But so then we divide up. I only gave us an example. This would be like a ticket or a schedule for what I would call group 1A, and you'll see like we would divide the groups into two, and so group one would go off for their first hour of essay instruction with one of our ELA teachers. So we actually had to add one this year because we got such a great turnout. So we had Ms. Hargrove and Ms. Dabriel from our ELA departments do an hour on really that, getting the essay started and brainstorming and things like that. And we purposely scheduled the second day for 48 hours later for the Thursday because we encourage the students, and I don't know if they all took us up on the offer, but, you know, in the middle of summer, but to really maybe start writing an essay or come up with a topic that then they could come back the second day and they really focus on editing and, you know, maybe a first draft or just kind of continuing or editing what they've done. Meanwhile, you know, group two would be rotating through some mini seminars. These are the topics that we got from students from student interest. So in this example, I'll say, you know, if group one rotates out of the essay instruction, they're divided into further groups, probably group one A, B, and C, so into thirds. And, you know, in this scenario, group one A would come through a 30-minute presentation with a guidance counselor on how to complete the forms they need to get letters of recommendations that they'll need from us, the counselors, and from the teachers. They'll then continue on for in the next half an hour, researching college application requirements, which this is actually one of the more difficult things for students. There's something like 4,000 undergraduate institutions in the United States, you know, of 2 or 4 year, and all their requirements can be different. And sometimes it's not easy to find out, you know, what do I need? Do I need to write an essay? How many letters of rec do I need? Am I supposed to send testing? Am I not? So we go over that with the students and some tricks for doing that. And then on day two, you know, we would come back together. There would be a check-in. Again, using the example of group one would get their second hour of essay instruction, as I described before. And then group two would be rotating through the mini sort of seminars, but then you'll see when it was time to switch that, group one A here comes in and we review a month-to-month senior year timeline with them, kind of go through maybe, you know, September, October, November, the things that you want to be doing each month. And then we were able to offer the students, we called it an elective choice. So they've, you know, at this point, everyone had the same three sort of mini seminars, but then we're able to offer them an elective. So when they register, they choose for your last half hour mini seminar, would you like to attend one on the college interview using a search engine, some of the different tools that we have through our Naviance program, or like the College Board search engine, a couple of different ones if you're still looking to build your list of schools, and then, or they can come and do a review of the tools that are available in Naviance. I know over the years, Naviance is a really great program, and it's our online tool, and I think I presented it to the school committee before. But it just, in case you're not familiar with it, it allows us to do just about everything we need to do in terms of the college application process and search process. It also has tools around career and even course academic planning. So we can get into more depth with some of the tools during that seminar. And then we brought everyone back together, to the distance learning lab for a question and answer session, which we added this year, and I thought it was great because they really, you know, it allowed people to, they were ready to get out of here too at this point, but I guess it's Thursday in August, but they allowed to ask some last questions, it allowed us to ask them some questions about, their experience and what was, you know, what they're finding was really helpful and things that we might want to add, et cetera. So we're hoping to be running it again this summer, again in August, I would think, and we've been excited to be able to offer it, and I think it has helped with the application process in general for the seniors.
This is exactly what you get at a private school. Is this free of charge to our students too, or do we charge a...
So we charge a fee for basically pay the faculty.
Hope we're charging a fee because this is the kind of in-depth one-on-one kind of help you get at a private school. And, you know, we're not a private school, obviously, so this isn't something that's in our budget.
Do you know what the fee is?
Yeah.
Very Reed, right?
Yeah, $50. $50 a student, and we offered it. We allowed students to indicate if they receive free or reduced lunch to charge just the $25.
Based on what you're offering here, that's a bargain. Huge bargain.
That's why I want
ask the parents if that's a bargain too. Because
I know my children are younger, but if you think, you know, again, I think they'll have maybe a draft of the essay done and, you know, maybe 80-90% of that Common App done. I think it's helpful. And
another question.
Yeah, please.
How soon do you have this scheduled? Because I would think parents would want to schedule
around it,
their vacations around this. I know I would.
Yeah, absolutely.
So do people have advanced?
Yeah. So what we did last year, and we're always sort of watching the dates and trying to figure out, you know, sometimes it can be a little fluid. When's Common App opening? I mean, it traditionally has been August 1st, but they've made some changes in the last couple of years, so we watch that. But we try and do a save the date, I would say fairly soon. You know, here we are in December, but kind of a save the date, like we're planning this Tuesday and Thursday. It is hard because you get some people who are committed to, you know, vacation that week, and you know, it's hard. But we try and say, you know, it's extra, and this is obviously pretty in-depth. But, you know, we do still meet with the seniors and do, like, a senior seminar through the civics and government classes at the beginning of the year. So we're still available for all of those things, too. But, no, I appreciate the point, too, that I think, you know, some private schools offer it, I think, and charge a fee on top of it. And I've run into some comparable programs, and I think we've been able to, you know, keep the price really low, I think, compared to some others. So it's been really good.
Great idea.
Yeah. Like I said, it was really, the thing I liked most about it is I was able to really meet with students and talk to them about what they wanted and develop it that way, which I think just makes it that much stronger of a program. I think we have some attendees here. Alumni of the Common Application Program, yeah. Jensen, you just didn't like the push-ups in the morning. Otherwise, it was okay, right?
3 mile run.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, I know. No one thought of us back then, right? Thank you very much. I appreciate it. Yeah, thank you for having me.
So I just want to thank Mike and Jess and Matt and Mr. Downs, who is here to, I think, again, like myself, just take a moment and, you know, evaluate the work that we're doing and the attention to, you know, not only what specifically defines the classroom instruction, but also, again, to look at the breadth of what we can do for all of the students in all of their needs and the unique ways in which we can look to accomplish that task. Thank you.
I just want to say, I mean, I know we usually like to have it's great to have the students here, but I kind of like this change of pace tonight because, you know, all three programs I thought were excellent, and I like getting the expertise from the people that either came up with the idea or are running the programs. I think it was, I just like this tonight. And the one thing for Jess, I really, this drives Jerry crazy. I'm really getting big into this mindfulness stuff, and I just hope that in some ways our schools, you know, short of you know, having yoga in the classrooms, you know, meditation. I've read so much about it and how it works instead of detentions and etc. And I just hope that we, you know, we can move in that direction as the rest of the country moves in that direction. I think Jerry would be a good meditation teacher.
Mel never made it home from Woodstock, really. Physically, yeah, but he never really did.
My mind is still at Woodstock, yeah. I'm going to email you because I'm friends with a guy down in Austin, Texas, who's kind of been given the job of running the whole mindfulness program for the district down there. So I'm going to email you his contact. He's got some great stuff that I think would be really helpful.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, we're moving.
Student report.
Student.
She's presenting. She's got it, yeah. You can
do jazz. Whichever.
No, go ahead.
Oh, okay.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Thank you. So Megan Griffin is here to speak about a new club that she is looking to get approval for, a new student club at the high school that goes by the acronym SEED. Students to End Alzheimer's Disease, and I'm going to let her talk about it. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Megan. I'm a junior at the high school right now, and I'm looking to start this club. So SEED is a student-led movement with one goal, which is to end Alzheimer's disease. And of course, we don't expect to end Alzheimer's disease, but the goal is to start the movement, to help it. We're going to do this by a lot of fundraising and volunteerism. Students have the opportunity to volunteer at many facilities around North Reading and within our community. At the high school, We have held one meeting so far, and we had about 35 members attend, so there is a good interest in it. I've been in contact with the Alzheimer's Association, and they've been a really good resource for me to get information on how caretakers and people with disease react to outside volunteers coming into their lives. So I think that through the meetings that I hold, I can give a lot of the club members good information of what we want to accomplish when we go to Meadowview Center is the nursing home we're looking to start it at. So we have a couple events that we want to do, and we want to invite researchers from the Alzheimer's Association to educate students. Either maybe, I know we have an initiative here called Lunch with a Scientist, so we can maybe have them come in and speak to the students at a whole, or just at a club meeting in particularly, so the kids who are volunteering really know why we're doing it and why it's so important. Specific art awareness events. Personally, I really like reaching out to kids who are interested in so many different things. I think it's great to be well-rounded and have friends from different groups. So by reaching in to the kind of art community, theater, and things like that, I think I can spark a new interest there. And they can create murals or other projects to help raise awareness for this. Fundraising events is bake sales, of course. Those are always a great way to do it at the school. Donation jars, I know that I believe during the food pantry week, we put little boxes in the classrooms so that students can just drop in coins and then they end up going towards that organization. So that would be something I'd look to start. And car washes, sports teams in the past have been very successful with doing car washes to raise money for them. So this would be a good way to raise money for the Alzheimer's Association. And then charity walks, of course, which I also are very successful in raising money. The Jimmy Fund does them. And cancer awareness walks, so it's another thing I want to get going. Specifically through the Alzheimer's Association, which is the leading research for Alzheimer's, they have the longest day event, which people join teams, fundraise, and participate in an activity for all of or part of the longest day of the year. Typically that's held in June, which is Alzheimer's Awareness Month. There's walks to end Alzheimer's, which I've already touched upon, which is just a great way to raise money. Very popular, you can meet a lot of good people, and it's just a really good way to get involved with your community and the association. And then research events, one of the goals of SEED is to be a resource for information related to Alzheimer's disease and Alzheimer's research, and by bringing in speakers, especially from the Alzheimer's Association, we can spread a lot of awareness that way. So I also mentioned also Meadowview Center, which is located on North Street in North Reading. I've been in contact with their publicity director and the director of the nursing home. They're really excited about this club. They think it's a great idea. I have signed the volunteering that we're going to do over there. It can't be counted towards the community service that is a requirement for the junior and senior classes, but it can go towards the Presidential Servants Award. And it's not a ton of hours. I think it's going to be on a biweekly basis for 1 hour. But just go over there and read to them, talk to them, paint nails for some of the elderly women. They really like that. Anything, just to get them involved, because most of them don't get a ton of visitors. And to be a part of the club, since it's definitely kind of based around volunteering, people have to attend the monthly meetings so they know what's going on. And there's going to be 3 scheduled Alzheimer's walks. The dates come out later in 2017 because the weather will be nicer in Massachusetts, so we'll be able to do those. And then because of the how frequent we're going to be volunteering over at Meadowview Center, you only have to attend 4 of those sessions to be considered a member of the club throughout the year. That's it. So no high schools so far have started a club like this, but I did contact Bentley University and UMass Amherst, and they do have clubs over there, and they've been really successful so far. So I got information from
them. I was curious, Megan, how did you, I was thinking of the uniqueness of this myself, how did you come up with this idea?
I have a few relatives who have been affected by Alzheimer's disease, and my uncle, he actually got diagnosed with early onset Alzheimer's, so he was over at Meadowview Center. for the last couple of months, and just being over there, I would go over there almost every week, and you just see how many people don't have visitors, and it's heartbreaking. So I thought it would be a great way.
That's great.
You know, one of the things that I've had, probably all of us have been touched by this disease, but I just read an article. There's a really, there's a new treatment that they're testing. It's laser lights. I don't know if you've heard about that, but mm-hmm. they think that they can eliminate, destroy some of the plaque in the brain by using these laser lights instead of medication. It just might be something you want to look into. I think it's a really cool new treatment that one of the drug companies just started testing. Yeah. So
unfortunately, that does not seem to be permanent. It's a temporary thing.
Yeah.
Anything in the right direction.
My neighbor, my dear friend Dennis Maraska, his wife has early onset Alzheimer's. She's at Meadowview. She's been there for 4 years, wow. upstairs in the Alzheimer's section up there. And I spoke to him today about this, and he was very excited about it. So he's been very active in the fundraising at the national, the state, and the local level. We've done the walk for the last 5 or 6 years. He's been instrumental in raising money for Alzheimer's research. But if you want somebody like him to come in and speak to the group once it's up and running, I think you'd find it very, very... I mean, he's gone through all the trials and tribulations that you go through with a spouse that has Alzheimer's. And with Elaine, it started when she was basically 52 or 53 years old.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah. I actually met her over there a couple
times. You did
meet
her. Yeah. Yeah. So that's a great thing that you're doing. I'm just amazed. It seems to be so unique and so special. So
thank you. Mm-hmm.
Good luck with it.
Thank you.
Is feeling. They put you in gloves that affect the way you feel things, put pebbles in your shoes, and it would be something awesome for you to offer for the club members as well as family members to really get in, to get a feeling, you know. And they would give you a task, simple task, but you had these other elements interfering. And it was difficult to set a table based on that. So definitely check with Mary Prinny at the Senior Center.
Yeah, that's a really good idea. Thank you.
Now, do you have is there a teacher that's already volunteered to?
Yes, Miss Gagnon. She is a new teacher from last year, but I had her as an algebra teacher, and I really liked her. So she's been really helpful in getting.
So she'll be the.
She would serve as the advisor. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I think it's wonderful. Mm. You presented extremely well.
Great job. Anyone with a relative or somebody that they know close that has had Alzheimer's identifies real quick with the need.
Thank you.
So I'll make a motion to approve for a 2-year pilot the extracurricular club students to end Alzheimer's disease at North Reading High School.
A second.
Motion made and seconded. Any further discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? None. Unanimous. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And now we'll go to student report.
Well, before we go to the student report, though, I mean, 7:15, 7:20, Jensen, come on.
I'm sorry.
That's all right. I'm only kidding you.
My apologies.
No problem.
We have Jensen Heitemann.
There you go. to start, athletics. Winter sports are in full swing. They've just started. And the boys and girls track team are 1-1 after their first meet, which was held at Reggie Lewis track in Boston. They beat Manchester Essex, both boys and girls, and they lost to Pawtucket.
They did lose.
And boys basketball will have their first game at Newburyport High School on Friday. Hockey, there'll be their home opener versus Pawtucket this Wednesday. And they beat a Super 8 team, Reading, for the third time in a row and in a scrimmage. And the girls basketball game is against Latin Academy is going on right now. Wrestling, Pentucket, they will be going against Pentucket on Wednesday. And swimming will be going against Shawshing Tech on Wednesday. For the performing arts, Oliver was a great success with a great number of people attending all four performances. The Political Society will be hosting Representative Brad Jones on January 5th to come and talk to all those who are interested. Guidance held a meeting discussing scholarship information, and early decision and early action decisions have been starting to come out from various other from various colleges. A lot of great community service has been completed, and their requirements were due this past Friday. And students in the junior and senior class have submitted their hours. Student Council will be having an in-house leadership conference this Friday on the half day, and it'll be run through the student council officers. And nomination for state awards for individuals have been, they've been working on that with various members in their student council group who have shown exceptional leadership qualities in the student council group. Lunch with a scientist. There will be a forensic scientist visiting North Reading High School on December 15th in the distance learning lab. The spots have all been filled with great interest from various grade levels. The Hour of Code was held for middle school and high school students. What it is, I also learned about this, is that students will use computer programming and code for an hour each day. And it's a lot of companies in and around North Reading and in the community have spoken about possible career choices in the computer programming field and in the technology field, encouraging students to get more involved in computer programming and coding. Women in Science is a program that was held on Saturday at Bedford High School to encourage more women to seek out the STEM fields in science and technology and engineering mathematics. And for my student work sample, I brought in a coil pot. So this is something that I made in ceramics. We were instructed to roll out like long coils and create a pot starting with a base and working upwards. This was a little unique in terms of the coil pots because most students started with a base and worked upwards. But instead, I used a mold and the pot started upside down. So I created coils and I rolled them up, and then I would smooth the outside of it out, and the coils would be shown on the inside and such. So this was based from Miss Atsalis's class where she talked about how Greek pottery was done in such a way. So I can pass this around, it's pretty cool. And the glaze was just added on afterwards. So the original product would be like dried out, and it would be placed in a kiln where it would be fired. I believe it's 1,200 degrees, I think. And it would be fired, and so the color would turn from a brown to like a more white color, as you can see in the back. And then the glaze would be applied afterwards. And there are different kinds, so.
For some reason, it looks like part of Picasso's Starry Night.
Oh, yeah. It does, yeah.
You mentioned, and we had so much going on tonight, the Maskers performance. I've been to a zillion of them. This was the best I've ever seen. It was unbelievable.
It seems to be a
It was unbelievable. The performances, the scenery. You can tell that we're getting to a point now where we know what we're doing in the Performing Arts Center. The sound quality was much better. You could hear the dialogue. You could hear the lyrics. It was just. And of course, the costumes are unbelievable, I must say. I have a personal interest in the costumes, but it was just unbelievable. I don't know if everybody saw it, but it was tremendous.
I agree, Mel. I've only been going for the last few years, but it was, and they've all been great.
Yeah.
Like Peter Pan, Christmas Story.
Singing in the Rain, with Annie Tag.
That was fantastic, and it was, you're right, it was, the set was unbelievable.
It was unbelievable.
The little things, like watching them move that set around and put it into interlocking pieces using the same set, but in different
ways, different angles.
And The costumes, you're right. The orchestra is fantastic. They do an unbelievable job. Saturday, Friday night, when I got there, I think they were only about, they weren't even two-thirds sold out. And they had enough walk-ins that the place was almost packed on Friday night by the time the show started. But it was tremendous, absolutely tremendous, yeah.
One thing that I really liked was outside in Main Street, in addition to the cast and pictures of the cast, they had the set design and seeing how things drawn to scale on the graph paper. Crazy. I don't think, especially kids of my daughter's age, really understand how you design a set and how intricate and how, you know, it involves lots of math and you know, architectural skills. And I really appreciated seeing, you know, those beginning drafts to then the end product. I thought it was really cool.
And again, they have so much to work with. I mean, they have the set production room right across from the back of the stage.
We got the tools, we got the workbenches, we got.
But there's so much work that goes in behind the scenes. I mean, and like I said, just the changing, it's crazy how they change the set with the curtain open, and you're not really watching them because you're watching something else that's going on the stage, and yet the whole set gets changed in front of you.
That was wonderful.
It was really good. Yeah. Really good.
Build it and they will come.
Yeah,
absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely.
And they've done a phenomenal job.
Brother
Jensen.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks, Jensen.
And you're forgiven for being.
Yeah, wait. I was only kidding you.
Sorry.
Don't ever do it again, though.
I won't.
And relay that to your sister.
The next item on the agenda is the Athletic Facilities Committee. Member appointment and reappointments. And you want to cover that?
You know, I can, Mr. Chairman. I'm sorry. I think there was a little bit of confusion around the action that this committee needed to take, and that I've been in conversation with the town clerk and with the town administrator and with Abby Hurlbut, the chairman of the finance committee. And it appears that the appropriate action to be taken by the school committee is to simply appoint, provide the opportunity for a liaison from the Finance Committee to serve as a non-voting member on the Athletic Facilities Committee.
Yes, I think we'd rescind, rescind the last motion.
Of the November 21st meeting.
Right, and then make a new motion.
That's correct.
Okay.
Do you want to?
Yeah, so I'll make a motion I'll make a motion that we rescind the motion we approved on November 21st to appoint a voting member to the Athletic Facilities Committee from the Finance Committee.
A second.
You said non-voting member.
I'm rescinding.
Oh, you're rescinding.
The voting member, okay. Yeah.
That's seconded.
Yep. Jerry's
made and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Unanimous.
And now I'll make a motion to allow the Finance Committee to appoint a non-voting liaison to the Athletic Facilities Committee.
Thank you.
A second. Just for discussion purposes.
Made and seconded. Further discussion.
We lucked out. They can't vote. Okay. This is just a lucky break that we got.
They will vote at some
point. They will vote at some point, yes.
So are they aware they're not voting?
Yes.
Yeah.
They came up with
They can't, because of their role in the town government, they can't be a voting member of another.
It would be a conflict
prohibited by the
charter,
basically.
Yeah.
Right.
Other committee.
Just happened to work out that way.
Yeah.
Right. Made, seconded, discussion. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And now I'll make a motion to reappoint to one-year terms, John?
Correct. I think so. I mean, I'm suggesting that just given the work ahead.
Okay. Reappoint to one-year terms the following members of the Athletic Facilities Committee: Marty Tilton from Parks and Rec, Ed Madden, community representative, and Chuck Carucci, a community representative. John reached out to all three of them, and all three have expressed interest in remaining on the committee.
Second.
In that, it made and seconded discussion. And that term would end January 31st.
Yes,
2018. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Unanimous. And we have minutes. Executive session, November 7th.
I'm going to confess that I didn't get a chance to go through these thoroughly this week, so I can't really take the lead here.
Make a motion to accept minutes from November 7th, 2016, executive session.
Second.
Made and seconded. Any further discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous. Open session for November 7th.
To make a motion to accept our minutes from the November 7th, 2016 open session.
Second.
Made and seconded. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous. November 21st, executive session.
I'd like to make a motion to accept our minutes from November 21st, 2016 executive session.
Second.
Made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Unanimous. November 21st, open session.
And lastly, make a motion to accept our minutes from the open session November 21st, 2016.
Second.
Made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Unanimous. Next item on our agenda is a budget update. Mr. Conley.
Very good. Thank you. In this evening in your packet was the December budget update, which reflects activity through the month of November. Some of the trends that we've been speaking to this fiscal year continue to be the same. You'll see that there is funds available in the special education tuition account. That is because we prepaid special education tuitions and we exceeded the amount we budgeted during the fiscal 2017 budget process. I will note, as discussed in the report, that I do anticipate needing to use some, if not all, of those funds that are projected as a balance at this point later this fiscal year to meet student needs. The exact financial impact of some of that is unknown at this time, but there are certainly some needs on the horizon with special education tuitions. We have encumbered all utility expenses, and we will continue to monitor the cost of utilities closely this fiscal year. I do anticipate needing to spend the majority of our electricity budget, and certainly depending on the severity of the winter months, we will have to see if there will be funds available in our gas budget to reapportion or not, which has been the case in the past. I will note that we have been experiencing higher than anticipated costs to maintain, in particular, the heating and cooling equipment, HVAC equipment in particular, really throughout the district, certainly in particular at the high school, middle school campus. So it's certainly something that we've been able to manage throughout the first half of this fiscal year to date, but it's certainly something that I think we'll need to pay very close attention to, and I'm certainly working very closely with Wayne Hardacre to monitor these expenses and try to get a handle on it as we approach the final half of the fiscal year. But I think it was definitely worth mentioning this evening.
And Michael, if I could, I actually I gave Michael a call this week because on the last two or three warrants we've signed, I've noticed HVAC mechanical repair at 10,000, 11,000, and I hadn't really seen that many of those before. And I think, and I know Michael and John and Wayne are already working through this, we need to take a good look at this for future budgets in terms of either is it more personnel we need, is it more money we need, is it a better understanding of how to run the system that we need sure. to make sure.
And I think we have to highlight it as a cost,
yeah.
a cost that we've inherited here now.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's not education.
It's a little bit of a combination of everything that
needs to show up as a very distinct budget
right,
item.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly, Cliff. Thank
absolutely.
You.
So we are certainly working on it, but something that's been on the forefront these last several weeks in particular. We talk about the food service program each month, and we closed out the month of October and even November at this point with a small net loss. In October, we lost about $1,900. November, we actually ended up losing about $500 in the month of November. But meals sold at the elementary level are very similar to last year. We're up slightly at the middle school and high school from previous years, but as you recall, last 2 years we experienced significant increases in meals sold per day at the middle school and high school. A positive note, though, despite the losses the last couple of months, they were very minor. Our net loss through this time last year is significantly less. We're actually operating in the black as we earned a profit of about $5,000. The month of September. So at this point, through the first 3 months of the school year, through November, we're actually operating at a profit of about $2,000. where at this time last year, we were actually in the red by at 16,000.
That's a positive deficit?
Yes.
Yes, yeah, it is, yeah. So we are over, you know, through the first 3 months, we're in the black, which is a very encouraging sign for the program. And we'll continue to monitor those costs as we normally do. And then on the payroll side, as I've been saying in the past, again, we budgeted a higher amount than we had in the past for that staff turnover estimate, and then we've spoken to that in the past, so we may be seeing a little bit of a less of a projected balance at this point in teacher accounts and salary accounts, but most the salary accounts are within budgeted ranges. So at this point, I'll just turn it over. Any questions in particular on the budget update? I have one other note, just a memorandum and an update. This is actually a pretty extraordinary spreadsheet of in-kind as well as, you know, cash donations through July through December 8th this fiscal year. And incredibly, as the spreadsheet details, we have received a total of $183,762.39 through December 8th from July 1st this fiscal year. So that's just extraordinary. You can see the amount of support that we've received from a variety of support groups, private donors that are on this list, helping fund expenses like athletic team expenses, fitness equipment, transportation expenses for field trips. Certainly the sod and the irrigation field project is a large chunk of that. The little school playground is a big piece of this as well. Technology equipment, funds for other enrichment activities across the district. So pretty amazing, the list of donations, and this is only halfway through the fiscal year.
And that number is through the 8th.
Through December 8th.
Not the stuff we're gonna do tonight.
Right, yeah, right. Some of the stuff tonight is not on here. Correct. So pretty amazing. Some of the items are listed on here that we anticipate being approved tonight, but just an extraordinary list of donations, really. So we definitely appreciate the support.
Anything further for Mr. Connolly? We'll move on to, there's no staffing, we'll move to bids and donations. We have a number of donations this evening. We have someone pick up on these.
Other one. I move to accept with gratitude a $250 donation from the Friends of Hornet Productions, which I believe is a middle school organization,
correct.
Drama, theater, music.
That's
For use of the Batchelder Elementary Field, for the Batchelder School, for use of the Batchelder Elementary Field for
correct.
The haunted
that's right.
Halloween event.
Second.
Made and seconded, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous.
I move to accept with gratitude an in-kind donation of 10 two-way radios and headsets valued at $389.98 for the purpose of tech crew communications during theatrical and video productions in the Middle School High School Performing Arts Center. And again, the donor is the Friends of Hornet Productions.
Second.
Made and seconded, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I move to accept a classroom carpet for a place to sing and play from donorschoose.org, which is a very interesting website. If you've never gone to it, there's all kinds of things you can donate to on that website.
Mm-hmm.
And it's been very successful, especially with a lot of the inner city urban schools. But it's a donation from donorschoose.org valued at $479. And this is for the music classroom at the Hood Elementary School.
Second.
Made and seconded, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous.
And a third one tonight from the Friends of Hornet Productions. I move to accept with gratitude an in-kind donation of 20 gold-colored metal picture frames valued at $624.80 for the purpose of displaying photos of theater, chorus, and music students in the Main Street corridor.
Second.
Made and seconded, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous.
Fourth one from the Friends of Hornet Productions. They must have that Halloween event must have been very successful. That they had that
they are a working group.
I move to accept with gratitude a $748.50 donation from the Friends of Hornet Productions to purchase the performance rights to Alice in Wonderland Jr. for the students of the middle school.
Second.
Made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Unanimous.
And then finally, I move to accept with gratitude a donation of $10,000 from North Reading High School's Hornet Hall of Fame to support costs associated with upgrades to North Reading High School's athletic facilities, including an irrigation sprinkler system.
Second.
Made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous.
And once again, thanks to everybody in the community for the generosity, ongoing Amen. Generosity.
Very generous. Next, we have information, subcommittee updates. The athletic subcommittee met on November 29th. Mr. Benazia?
We talked, the athletic director gave us a projected number of athletic signups for the winter season, which was about 295 students. There were 50 kids that signed up for hockey. There were 72 that signed up for basketball. That's boys and girls basketball, 37 for swimming. And we also had two students, and we're hoping to get more, that signed up for the cooperative ski team in Haverhill, which is really the first crack that we've had at this. So we're hoping to get more kids for that. And Dave Johnson was kind of optimistic that we would. We pretty much then went into discussions about the athletic facilities committee. So Mel, maybe we can kill two birds with one stone here. But we talked about, Mel gave a good summary of the updates at the facilities meeting on how much money we've collected and how much money we still have to raise.
Right. We so to kind of piggyback on with the Athletic Facilities Committee, at our last meeting, we presented that we need to raise slightly more than $23,000 to pay back the loan that we received from the school department in order to complete the project. We raised approximately $135,000. The total project cost with engineering fees came to about $158,000 plus. And at that point, we didn't want to say, well, we've got $135,000, we're not going to do the job. We wanted to get it done. It got done. It looks great. The irrigation works. And so now we actually have a couple of fundraising events that we hope to have in the next several months.
Put together a subcommittee, myself, Dave Johnson, and
Chuck
Carucci.
Right.
So we've got two fundraisers in particular, Las right. Vegas night and a golf ball drop that
right.
we hope to meet. We have a meeting scheduled, and we've already done some work on getting a commitment from the Hillview
okay.
To have an event there. So we're going to do that right after the holidays. As a side note, Mel, too, I just wanted to point out that by lending the $23,000, the revolving account is pretty much going to be zero balance
exactly.
at the end of the fiscal year, if not a little bit in the red. So
right.
it's important that we try to raise the money mm-hmm. to, that's going to be the first objective, is to repay the school department the $23,000 that we had to use.
And then there was we do have a list, and I don't have it with me, but there's a list of items that we want to mm-hmm. purchase, which I think comes to around $20,000 to $25,000
yeah.
for that list of items.
27 or
27,000, I think it was. Because the total
50,
of the two was about 50.
Right, right. including equipment, et cetera.
Correct.
And the equipment, just for people to know, again, we might have talked about this before, we're looking to get some additional soccer goals for the new all-purpose field. We're trying to get dugout enclosures for the softball field. We need bleachers for the softball field for people to sit at. We're looking at potentially getting a scoreboard for softball, as well as a batting cage. And some gates around the dugout. So there's a number of things that we want to do, and the total was about 27 or 28,000.
Also the dugout enclosures too.
Right.
So, and then tomorrow night we will have another athletic facilities committee meeting where we will have representatives from CBI, which is the engineering firm which has already done quite a bit of work looking into the restroom/potential concessions facility at Arthur Kenny Field. And they'll be in presenting tomorrow night. The Athletic Facilities Committee has been charged with making a recommendation to the Board of Selectmen for that
mm-hmm.
facility. And I did hear talk at the last Selectmen's meeting about a good potential for a special town meeting in March related to the part of the Berry property that is, these proposals have just come in. So I'm hoping we can move this along pretty quickly. So if there is a special town meeting in March, we can have something on the ballot then, and hopefully get that completed in the summer. And so for the fall next year, we'll have restroom facilities at the.
As Bell said, we have the same engineering company coming in that we had $30,000 to spend. No, was it $30,000? $50,000 to spend on engineering. And they made a presentation before October town meeting. Yeah, we passed over this in October, and we're having them come in again, and the committee's going to try to shape or frame where we want to go with this and then make a recommendation.
Right, and to be fair to CBI, they were under probably an impossible deadline the last time around, and then we asked them to come back with changes within like 24 hours, and, you know, they just didn't. That's why the committee decided not to go forward at the.
And hopefully the amount of time that has passed, they'll come back.
Yes.
Yeah.
Very succinct.
Yeah, and they've actually had 10 days, they've had 2 weeks to know that we wanted them here on the 13th, tomorrow night, so they should have their act together, yeah.
I think that's pretty much
the
athletic facilities and the athletic subcommittee.
I think the secondary school building committee met on the 29th as well, and the upshot of that is really what was covered in the MSBA, SSBC, report, and basically that was that we're working to finalize the clean up the items that are on the punch list that are possible to do, all the inside work and the exterior work, probably on the drainage and the roadway coming back in the late spring or in the summer to wrap that up, finish the paving work that needs to be done. Let's see, the subcommittee schedule is the SSBC meeting tomorrow night here at 5:30, and then athletic facilities committee after that at 6:15. NORCAM board meets on December 15th at 7. Finance planning team on the 16th at 8:15 a.m. in the superintendent's office. Athletic subcommittee on January 3rd in the superintendent's office. And then we go on to administrative report.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just a few things that I wanted to highlight for you in my report tonight. The first is I attached to my report a copy of a letter that I had received from one of the folks that we're working with on the Global Child Program. Very, very happy with that program that we started this fall. To provide somewhere in the area of 239 students, I believe it was, elementary school through middle school, an opportunity for foreign language in French, Spanish, and Chinese. And I think it's been very well received by the community, been very well received at the four schools, and we are planning to continue with a second session in the spring semester starting in February. So just a little update for you that I think that was a very, very successful start to an extracurricular program for students. I also attached for you the most recent letter regarding North Reading High School's accreditation by the New England Association of Schools and Colleges. If you have not yet had an opportunity to read the letter, I'm hoping that you can find the time to do that. It's a very favorable letter. It clearly articulates that North Reading High School's accreditation by the association, often referred to as NEASC by its acronym, speaks to only a couple of recommendations, which is very unusual. I've been through a number of high school accreditation visits in my 30 years in public education, and to have only two recommendations is very, very positive. And I think it really is a reflection of this community's support of education. I don't think that this is solely a high school accolade. I really do think it is a community accolade because it does reflect, I think, both the financial and the kind of the moral support that the community provides from pre-kindergarten right through graduation. And I'm going to provide Dan a copy of the letter in the hope that it can be summarized in the transcript, because I really do think the community deserves to see how an independent agency has come in and conducted a very thorough evaluation of the programs of the high school and how favorable they have reported on that. So,
Spinner, can you just give us what recommendations they did?
Sure. So if you look, in the letter,
the back page, but it seems pretty
general. Oh, you know what? I think it may not have copied on the back. Yeah, it was a double-sided. Sorry, it was a double-sided letter. There were two recommendations. One was on an advisory program, of which the high school has already started to implement, where there's a student, an adult in the school that serves as kind of an advisor to every student in the school. And that was one. I honestly don't remember what the second one was. And I don't have the original letter here. It's in my office. But it was not anything, there was nothing certainly glaring. But I will get you all. I'll scan and email you all a copy of the letter this evening. The next thing I would like to bring up is I had previously brought up for you about the special project stipends for the administrators. So I had sent some information to you on the requests that had come forward. I'd like to move forward with awarding those that are identified in the packet consistent with the administrator contracts. I don't know, we did talk about this at the last meeting, but if there are any questions that you have, I certainly would try to answer them for you. I don't think a vote is needed. I think it's more just a consensus to move forward.
I just want to say I'll support these tonight, but I also support a lot more discussion moving forward in terms of what these being in the contract, and also what's the definition of special extra work? Can we have a better, because I when I look at our budgets and our struggles, and I just sometimes have a hard time giving these extra amounts. I'm not saying the staff isn't doing the work.
I understand.
Because I look and I say, well, why don't teachers have these in their contracts, and why don't cafeteria workers have the, so I guess that's an issue.
I would offer three things to you. One is, I think it would be my desire to start to phase these out of the administrative contracts, because this process is very embarrassing, quite honestly. Secondly, all contracts have certain provisions in them that differ. For example, there are longevity provisions in some contracts that the administrators don't have. So I think there are nuances, I think, to many of them. Yeah. Thirdly, the definition, I think, as I view it, is when someone either proposes something that they want to do that's new and beyond the scope of their normal duties, or a request is made for them to participate in something like a building project, as an example. But to the first point you make about, the contract work, as I start to work with the administrators on negotiating their individual contracts, that would be a direction I'd like to go in, is to just, start to phase them out.
My feeling, John, is there's nothing to be embarrassed about. I think it's great that you come here on behalf of the administrators, because I've always been a big supporter of this. I think our administrative team is top-notch. I think in order to keep them here, sometimes you have to recognize them. One of the ways to do that is with financial support. I guess the concern I have is because of the budget situation we have.
Mm-hmm.
And when you say it's part of the contract doesn't require it. The contract...
No.
No, it does not. It's the option.
It allows to
correct.
It's an option. And it, quite frankly, it doesn't have to come to the school committee. It doesn't have to be a vote of the school committee. It's at the discretion of the
superintendent. Doesn't have to be made public.
We don't have to be transparent about
right.
it. We've always gone
that we've chosen
publicly
that, right.
so that everybody would know what we're doing.
Exactly.
It doesn't have to be that way. And in the past, we've received some criticism for it, but I don't think it's anything to be embarrassed about. Having said that, I am concerned that, again, with the budget situation that we have, that, I was hoping we would establish a baseline going forward for being extremely conservative in dealing with contracts and other compensations so that we can get through this budget season. And I thought this was a good place to start, to be honest with you. So that's just my concern about it. It's got nothing to do with them deserving it.
I understand.
I think they deserve it. And I appreciate everything they do, but I'm just concerned about the budget and the message that you send, going forward into this budget season. So.
Well, just if I could remind, this is for fiscal year 17. This money's same. Already been, okay, but as we look at fiscal year 18, I understand.
Yeah.
I guess my feeling is that with a professional, you really shouldn't have a separate piece that you're putting in for other things outside of their duties. Because as a professional, I know that my feeling has always been that I do whatever I need to do for the amount of money that I got as a salary. It's just I never looked for more than that. I never felt that I deserved more than that. That was it. And so I think that I don't have a problem with paying people what their value is and paying them for the job that they do. I just feel as though as a professional, it ought to be you get a salary and that's it. And that there's nothing more beyond that to pick up.
I kind of equate this with a bonus. You know, in the private world, you give out bonuses for people that, you know, do some extra work and stuff. But I'm just more concerned, not that we're considering it, but that the budget is going to put us in a position this coming year, this next fiscal year. That
I guess I'm what I'm saying is that I'm sort of expecting a professional to do the whole job for their salary, and that these separate pieces are messy. I think they ought to have the right amount of salary in the first place and not have little tag-ons for this thing and that thing. And
just from my understanding, just from what you're saying, the school was, the secondary school building committee had this school built, right? And you had to deal with extra stuff as the principal, as well as the superintendent, that was above and beyond their professional job, right? And that isn't that what the stipend is kind of assessed for?
Yeah, but I think what Cliff is saying is if you're an administrator in a school district, you're likely going to deal with the school building project at some point. You're likely going to deal with et cetera. And I don't necessarily disagree with Cliff on that. I think along the same lines.
There's a lot of little extra things that happen, and you just do them as a part of the job. That's what I always did.
I think that happens too.
45 years of it, and I got a salary, and
You got bonuses.
And if the company did well, I got a bonus.
No, but bonuses, Jerry, usually if the company has a highly profitable year or, you know what I'm saying? Yeah, and
listen, I support compensation to our administrators.
I do too.
And I always will. But I do think that we have to start viewing things a little bit differently going forward.
Yes,
John's right. This is for fiscal year 17 and not for the next.
That's my point too, going forward. I'm not
saying
with these. I'm saying as we move forward.
Yeah. I'd just like to see it. We get to do a single number that covers everything, and you do the whole job under that.
And then the last thing I wanted to follow up with the committee on was I did host a meeting on December 6th with three of the parents who had come to the last meeting to talk about the elementary recess. And joining me in that meeting was Mr. Colleen, Mrs. Molly, and Mr. McKay, the three elementary school principals. We met last week for just short of an hour, I think. And I'd like to think it was a good meeting, certainly very, very positive in terms of its tone and as you might expect, it was very respectful. I'm not going to say that I think the parents who were very, very pleasant to deal with, I don't know that they walked away necessarily thrilled with some of the information that was provided to them, because it didn't lead to, I think, something that they might have hoped to get. But I do think that, and certainly I got a very nice note from one of the parents, as I know Mr. Colleen did as well, a handwritten note mailed to me just thanking us for our time, giving them an opportunity to come in and share their concern and to hear a little bit more about some of the things that I don't think that they were familiar with were going on in the school that might help to kind of address the concern about physical activity during the school day and such. So all in all, I guess what I wanted to alert the committee to was the fact that we did hold a meeting. Again, I'm not so sure that folks walked away feeling as though they had gotten what they might have hoped for, but I do think that they did get a better understanding of how some of the schedule works at the elementary level, and that there are some pretty significant prohibitions that don't allow for us to increase the amount of time for recess at the elementary school level. As it stands now. So
it was unfortunate I couldn't attend because of my work schedule. I did put it out to the listserv just as a general survey what other districts were offering, especially at the elementary level, and they did seem to be 20 to 30 minutes. There was one that was, for contractual reasons, had a 49-minute recess schedule. So I think, and there was also a question about taking away recess time as more of a disciplinary action, and whether or not
illegal.
That was against state law. So I think perhaps keep this on our radar, because we may need to look further into those.
One of the things I did, I asked the three elementary principals to poll their faculties, and we shared that with the folks that were in attendance, and that's not happening, and I think they saw
that. I'm guessing it happened once or twice to somebody, and
there's a, I know
it has happened.
I think state law does it, according to what we were given, it's not legal.
There are choice options for students, is how it was explained to me by Mr. Colleen at the Batchelder School, that if a student wants to do the assignment during the recess, they can, or it can be taken home and done for the next day. So it's not, you know, I think when we shared things, stories like that, I think the parents had a better understanding that we're not, you know, we don't have 30 and 40 students being kept in for, you know, recess. Because
no, but even on something like that, John, the option may not be something you want to even provide them with. Mm-hmm. They may have to take their recess instead of having the option of doing the assignment.
Again, I think he cited two cases of that. But, okay. Yeah, I don't know that it was, you know, I'm very confident it's not a widespread matter that's going on. So.
But I think it's prudent of us to kind of keep it on our radar, because
I don't
necessarily think it will go away.
No. How many responses do you have? I only remember two.
I think I got 10, 12.
Maybe you got some direct, not on the serve.
And I just know of where I've been over the past.
You talk about the time?
The time.
Because I did that too. I did that among kind of my little peer group. And I learned as I started to get responses from people that I didn't ask the right question, because they were giving me the recess time, but what they weren't giving, I think the better question is, what's the total recess lunch time?
Okay.
Because there were some schools that had lunch, a 20-minute lunch,
yes.
Oh, exactly. As opposed to a 30-minute lunch.
You guys
lunch
hear from
we have.
So like American Idol, they can vote five or six times when they contact you, or?
I'm not.
What do you mean?
School committee.
School committee members. Committee members.
Because they could be voting multiple times.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Future business, January 9th, regular meeting here at 6:30. January 23rd, 6:30 at the Batch. And February 6th, 6:30 at this location. And the middle school will have a presentation for that. Move to adjourn?
Move to adjourn.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Unanimous.
Does the hush know we're coming to adjourn?